This ETF usually does really well in August, and there are leveraged ETFs on the market. First off, read this disclaimer carefully. In this video, we will look at the bonds. Specifically, we will look at the 20 plus year treasury bonds. We will look at the TLT, which is, you know, the underlying, and the two leveraged alternatives, the TMF if you are bullish, and this one, the TMV if you are bearish. You can see here that from the 52-week low, the TMF, the bullish triple leveraged, is up 81%. That's pretty darn good. So that's 81% for the TMF. If you look at S&P 500, it is up 47%. So that's something to take into account. Okay, let's look a bit at the TLT. Looking at the seasonality, it becomes quite interesting here for the TLT, because we are currently, you know, in July, which historically is, you know, given a lot of history, okay, this is from 2002 to 2020, a lot of history shows us that it usually does well in July and really good in August. That's quite interesting. September is not that bad either. October is bad, but yeah, we are heading towards a historically good season for the TLT. That's interesting. Let's look at it against the S&P 500. Okay, let's go further back, get more data. Here it gets interesting. So here we are looking at the percentage of months in which the TLT outperformed the S&P 500. And you can see here, July is not especially good, but here again, August is historically, given the actual facts and data, is really good. That's interesting. That's quite interesting. So this is the ETF. That's the benchmark, the TLT. There are options available for this one. Hence, if you want a leverage to play, you could certainly get options here on the TLT. To get into the triple leveraged TMF, this is the bullish one, and this here is the bearish one. Given that the seasonality is strongly suggesting a more bullish play, the TMF, you know, certainly makes more sense for August based on the current data. But let's explore it further. Let's look at the charts. These are weekly data points, and let's actually go way back in time here. Way back, we go way back. Okay, so here we get a lot of history for this. We actually do not get all the history. I'm not sure why we don't, but that's just how it is. But we do get some decent history. You can see here that we had this very long consolidation. Then we have a breakout, a quite solid breakout, a major rally here for the TLT. We have been consolidating for quite some time, which is actually kind of good, given that we are heading towards a very good season, a very good month. Hence, it is good that we have calmed down. And the saying is that the longer you go sideways, the bigger the breakout. It is nice to see also that from looking at the weekly data points, we are finding support at this purple 20-week moving average. Cooling down, finding support. So we have a bit of a... We have a pattern, basically, where you have the bears and then the bulls are gaining leverage. So there are higher highs recently and higher lows. So we are literally above all the moving averages now. That's good. Looking at the accumulation distribution line, it is also showing us bullish behavior. That's also good. The RSI has calmed down. Nice. The correlation with S&P 500 is 43%. Given that, you know, things can get a bit more dicey here for the S&P 500 and the Nasdaq, because the stock markets have had a rather extreme rally, it is nice to know that long term, the TLT and the S&P are not really that correlated. That's good. Okay. Let's look a bit at the daily data points before we do some study of the leveraged alternatives, okay? Looking at the dailies here, you can see that you have this clear, you know, clear consolidation pattern with a bit of a rounding-ish bottom formation. Looks certainly, based on, you know, the charts here as well, the bulls should be able to pull off something good here going forward, especially in August. Historically, it's very strong. They should be able to pull it off. I mean, it's right there in front of them, so yeah. If they blow it now, then yeah, there's no excuse at all. Yeah, looking at the correlation, minus 61% actually with the S&P 500, a negative correlation. That's interesting. Because that means if we do see some more weakness in the stock markets, it is, generally speaking, going to be bullish for the TLT. Given that we have not had that seasonal correction in the stock markets yet, and the seasons are speaking in favor of the TLT, you have a nice setup here. Okay, let's now do these studies, the correlations, because that's always very, very important. Okay, let's look at the TLT. So the TLT is now in the background. No surprise, there's a perfect statistical correlation between the TLT and the TLT. Okay, let's look at the TMF. So we're starting here with the bullish one. The correlation here is really, really, really good. It is basically a perfect correlation. That is really good for a triple leveraged product. So based on the math here on the weeklies, the TMF works really good. Really good as a leveraged way to get exposure to the 20-year treasury bonds. Let's look at the daily data points. Here we have a 99% positive correlation. That is what we want to see. This is a really, really, really good correlation for a leveraged product. Really good. Of course, when dealing with leveraged ETFs, you always have to be careful. They are not supposed to be held for more than one day, but the correlation here and the results have shown that you could, okay, from this low here to this high, that was a 277% gain. Pretty decent. Okay, let's look at the TMV. So this is the bearish one. Okay, here, okay, ignore this. This is a stock split that investing.com has not taken into account. Yeah, it's annoying, but they are slow when it comes to taking into account stock splits. Slow, even though, yeah, okay. Yeah, but we can do some correlation studies nonetheless. So ignore the chart here, just ignore it. But the correlation, okay, here there's minus 28. I'm just uncertain how much we should read into the correlation here because of this, their inability to just recalculate a stock split. Yeah, this is very annoying. This is a constant thing with investing.com. They are lousy. So anytime you see this, complain to their support group, because there's no excuse for this. It's simple programming. Yeah. There is a minus 75%. No, there isn't. No, there's a 75. Okay, just ignore this. Okay, there's no point in doing this correlation study here. But as we saw with the TMF, which is the bullish one, we saw that the correlation was really, really good. And the thesis here is, you know, bullish here for the TLT. That's my take. Let's quickly look at the ETFs. Let's look at the TLT here just to get some data. Here I can see options are available. The performance pretty good year to date, 23%. That's decent. That's very good. Looking at the TLT here, let's go to the dividend and valuation. So 1.7% dividend, that's pretty decent. Let's look at fund flows last 6 months. Yeah, we see certainly that even though it's been consolidating here over the last 3 months, there's been a general, there's been some spikes here in buying. That's interesting. Look at the holdings. No big surprise here. There's the 20-year treasury bonds. Yeah. So a bunch of different US treasuries. Here is the TMF, the leveraged one. Here is the expense ratio. And here is the bearish one. Of course, when dealing with these leveraged products, you need to be careful, and I have said that before. Okay, let's now look at the US 500. Like this, the futures. Okay, So you can see that there's some weakness and nothing dramatic yet. Yesterday was a strong-ish day, but even though the bulls tried to break out above this resistance level, they didn't actually pull it off. So even though the bulls have made a lot of progress, the bears could, if they really want to, they could, you know, push the bulls down a bit and make this a solid resistance level. So that's something to watch out for. The interesting thing that happened yesterday is that Twitter suffered a major hack, super big hack. It seems like the hackers got very deep into their systems, very deep. They took over the accounts of, you know, Barack Obama, even Twitter support, a bunch of celebrities, Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos. This suggests that it could be a rogue prior employee, that's possible. It could also be something called social engineering, which basically is someone calling Twitter and pretending to be a Twitter employee. High ranking often, and then they will pressure someone of a supposedly lower rank to give them access. So I think that's the most likely explanation. Someone just being able to, from a computer, hack into Twitter and get that deep access, that is unlikely. So I would bet either a rogue prior employee or social engineering. It could, of course, be a state actor, and we have seen that USA has been cracking down on TikTok and many social media platforms in China. It could be something like that, a backlash, but I'm not sure about that one. I wouldn't be surprised if China got the blame anyway. I mean, let's see, because there's some big politics in play. Big politics about who should rule the world, and that usually has some high stakes. But let's actually look a bit at Twitter here, given that it's kind of relevant. So the thing about Twitter is that it moves in these major cycles, massive cycles. So let's look at the time cycles. Let's see if we can get something clear, There are some smaller cycles, but they're not that consistent. Let's look at some of the more major cycles. Maybe we are seeing something here. Let's expand this one a bit. We are able to capture quite a few cycles here. Yeah, it's interesting. We are seeing in the pre-market that there will be a pullback here on Twitter. And we do have lower highs and lower lows. So this is not an ideal time for Twitter to get bad news. Yesterday, I did look at Palo Alto Networks. So let's actually go here to investing.com. Let's go to Palo Alto Networks. Let's see what's happening here in the pre-market. So we're not seeing any big rally here for Palo Alto Networks. Let's look at the hack, which is the cybersecurity ETF. Because given that there's been a major hack now, really nothing here is happening in the pre-market. Because you could make a theory that, okay, maybe there's going to be a spike here in the hack or some of the cybersecurity companies because some companies would invest more in cybersecurity now after the big hack. But there doesn't seem to be anything moving the market so far. Specifically, the hacking stocks. Okay. Whatever you do, of course, don't fight the trend. And may the trend be with you.